Hello, everyone. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Summer Youth Series. My name is Phil Wagoner, and I am part of the youth ministry team here at the Crieve Hall Church of Christ. And we thank you all for joining us tonight. This has been a wonderful Summer Youth Series. There have been some excellent speakers, and we have another one tonight. We thank you for joining us. We'll start with a word of prayer, and then we're going to have some songs. And if you're out there, join in song. You might press the mute button on your computer or your device, so because of the timing of it. But sing along. The singing is actually from the Summer Youth Series last year that we hosted here at Crieve Hall. Thank you for joining us. We will sing a few songs together and then introduce our speaker tonight. So let's sing together.
Oh,
All right, everybody. If you joined us late, hopefully you joined us in song. Don't feel like you're missing out. That was video and audio from our Summer Youth Series last year when we were together at Crieve Hall. But we are excited tonight to have a wonderful speaker. This summer, there have been so many great speakers as part of Summer Youth Series. Tonight is no exception. Philip Jenkins is with us tonight. And we're excited that Philip is with us. Want to say a few things. As probably you all know, Philip is youth minister at the Mount Juliet Congregation and is just finishing up his 10th year, I believe. And that is a special congregation near and dear to my heart. And Philip does a wonderful job as a youth minister there. Of course, he has a beautiful wife, Laura, and two beautiful children, Lucas and Holly, that we all love. And the theme for this summer is speaking the truth in love. And tonight, Philip's topic is speaking the truth in love about homosexuality. And we're excited that you have joined us and thankful for Philip. He's a good brother and a good friend and an excellent teacher and leader. And I want to, before I turn it over to Philip, I'd like us to go to God in prayer and pray about his topic tonight and for Philip. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, Father, we love you so much. Father, we thank you for waking us up today. Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have tonight to come together online. We thank you for Philip Jenkins. We thank you for his family. And we thank you for his example and the love that he has for you and the love he has for young people, the love he has for your church. And Father, I pray that you will be with him tonight as he shares your word and your teaching on this topic. And I pray that you will, Father, be with him and help him, Father, to speak the truth in love. And help us to always go to your word for any topic, Father, and listen to you and what you have to say, Father, and follow your word. We thank you. We thank you for Philip. Be with him tonight. Father, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. And Father, we thank you that you sent your only son, Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins. Father, thank you for everyone that's tuning in tonight. We thank you for all these congregations. We ask that you bless them. For every individual that's watching tonight, be with them and help us all be more like your son, Jesus, every day, the way that we live and we act. We ask that you hear our prayer, and we ask in all these things your will be done. All these things we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hey, thank you, Phil. It's good to see you. And I love Phil Wagner. I love Summer Youth Series. And I love singing at SYS, and I love singing SYS at Crieve Hall. You know, Phil said, don't feel like you're missing out. I do feel like I'm missing out. I missed that. I miss singing at Crieve Hall. Look forward to that every year. And I know you guys do too. I'm going to start by doing a thing. So give me a second to do a thing. I'm going to share my screen. And I thought we would start tonight with a good fight. It's a good way to start, right? So let's fight. Are you ready to fight? You guys know what's up. All right. This dress, or as I like to say, this gold and white dress. And that probably sent everybody in the room into a frenzy, and you're probably not listening to anything I'm saying right now, because there was a few years ago when this photo broke, and it really just sent everybody crazy. It kind of broke the internet. And you probably remember that, right? Some people see this photo in one of two different ways. I'm in the camp that sees it as gold and white. Maybe you're black and blue. I think it's navy and black or something like that. I can't see it that way. I have a really hard time seeing it. I don't know how you see it. But this is one of those pictures that as soon as you put it up on the screen, people are instantly divided, you know? And there are really a lot of things. I guess I could put a lot of pictures on the screen that would just instantly divide people. There are a lot of things that people are extremely divided over. A lot of people love Alabama football. A lot of people hate it. A lot of people love Tennessee football. Some don't. Some people love coffee. Some people don't. Some people, so many things like that can be divisive and become matters of opinion where, you know, and we kind of, at the end of those conversations, we sort of kind of throw up our hands and say, okay, well, that may be fine for you, but I see it this way. And there's a lot of issues that's kind of the way the conversation ends. Well, you might love UT football, but that's good for you, but it's not for me. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will cheer for Alabama. Me and Phil are both Alabama fans. But, you know, we treat the dress that way. Well, it might look gold and white to you, but you might see it differently. But we can just agree to disagree. Tonight, what I want you to consider is this. Is homosexuality a blue and gold dress issue? Is it a matter of, well, I see it this way and you see it that way? Or is it a different kind of issue? Tonight, I want to ask you to keep an open mind. You may be a guest listening to this tonight, and this may be the first time you've heard anything like this. And so I just want to ask everybody to keep an open mind. On the other hand, you may have been coming to church all your life and you're still not really sure where you land on an issue like homosexuality. I just want to ask you to keep an open mind and maybe be challenged in some things that you believe. So you may already be thinking, I know exactly what I believe about homosexuality, or you may be thinking, I'm not really sure what to believe about that. But regardless of where you are on this topic, when we sat down tonight, and when you sat down tonight, it's my prayer that we all have a better understanding and a greater compassion when it comes to homosexuality. I know Phil just said a prayer, but I would like to go before the throne of God and pray as well. So let's bow for a prayer. Lord, thank you again for this group who's tuning in tonight. And I pray that the things that I share, the things that we study, will be things that you want to be shared and you want us to study. And I pray that the things that are shared would be in accordance with your will. I pray you would give us greater compassion and greater understanding and help us to love each other like we should. In Jesus' name, amen. There are a lot of strong opinions about homosexuality. There are politicians that have really strong feelings about homosexuality. There are organizations that have very strong opinions about it. There are churches that have very strong opinions. Taylor Swift has an opinion about it. She wrote a song with her opinion about it. But remember this, none of that really matters, right? I really want that to sink in. None of that matters. In the grand scheme of things, it doesn't matter what a politician or a church or even a celebrity might think. We can get all bent out of shape about people's opinions on this, but there's really only one opinion that matters, right? And that's God's opinion. And so for the next few minutes, I want us to take a look in God's Word, and I want us to take a look in the New Testament to see what God's Word teaches about this topic. And by the way, notice that what I said there, a lot of times, and I mean a lot of times, people point back to the Old Testament when it comes to something like this topic. But I don't think that's a very good practice, because there's a lot of laws in the Old Testament that we don't observe anymore. So what I want us to do is to look in the new covenant, the law that we're under, the law of Christ, the one that we observe, and let's see what the New Testament says about this. We're going to go to like three different passages. The first one I want us to look at is 1 Timothy chapter 1, starting in verse 8. It says, "Now we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully. Understanding this, that the law is not laid down for the just, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and sinners, for the unholy and profane, for those who strike their fathers and mothers, for murderers, the sexually immoral, men who practice homosexuality, enslavers, liars, perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to sound doctrine, in accordance with the gospel of the glory of the blessed God with which I have been entrusted. All right, next passage, Romans chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions, for their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. Next passage, 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 and 10. Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Okay, so let's talk through what we just read and make some important observations. This is really important, I think. Which is worse, lying or practicing homosexuality? Which is worse, being a drunk or practicing homosexuality? Think about this one. Which is worse, heterosexual immorality or homosexual immorality? Listen, the truth is sin is sin, and it all carries the same price tag. So we don't need to treat homosexuality like it's something worse than all the others. It's not. There are no like big sins and little sins. All sins are big. They all carry the same price tag. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. That's the same price no matter what the sin is. But the good news, and that's the rest of Romans 6:23, the good news is that Jesus paid the price tag. The rest of that verse says the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. He died for liars, for adulterers, for murderers, for racists, for terrorists. He died for everybody who's ever committed a sin. He died for me. He died for everybody. So no matter what you've done or what you haven't done, he loves you. I repeat, he loves you. Next thing, is it a sin to be tempted? Is it a sin to be tempted? No. After all, wasn't Jesus tempted? And he never sinned. So let's think through this together. Is it a sin to have same-sex attraction? No. You will never find that teaching in God's word. In all the passages that we just read, the Bible makes a very important distinction. I'm going to look at these passages again, but I want to show you this. It's those who practice sin that are in the wrong. Here's the 1 Timothy passage. The sexually immoral, men who practice homosexuality, enslavers, liars, perjurers. Romans 1:27 describes those who are committing homosexual acts, not those who might have an attraction. 1 Corinthians 6 that we looked at says those who practice homosexuality. So I think it's an important distinction to make. And then, of course, James chapter 1, verses 14 and 15 talks more about how sin works. It says, each person is tempted when he's lured by when he's lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it has fully grown, brings forth death. So it is not a sin to be tempted. It's not a sin to have a desire to sin. And so that kind of leads us to an important question. When does a desire become sinful? When does a desire become sinful? A couple of things here. Number one, when our desires become actions. That's what the James passage was talking about. Sin occurs, verse 15, when that desire leads to sin. It's not when I'm tempted to steal. It's when I steal. All right. When else does a desire become sinful? When our desires become lust. When our desires become lust. You might not act it out physically, but if in your mind you're playing it out, remember when Jesus said this, Matthew 5, 27 and 28, you've heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Well, it's no big deal. I mean, it's not like I'm going to act on it. Jesus says, if you're lusting, you've committed the action in your heart and you're guilty of sin too. So when does a desire become sinful? Number one, when our desires become actions. And number two, when a desire becomes a lust. And lust is that action that's in our hearts. So is it wrong to have a desire? No, as long as we don't act on them. And as long as those desires don't lead to lust. So I say all of that to say that we have to be very, very careful about our desires. All right. So are you still with me? Please pay very, very close attention to the next part. Okay. Just stay with me. Stay with this line of logic and understanding of what the Bible says here. Is it a sin to be tempted? No. Is it a sin to have sexual temptations? No. Is it a sin to have same-sex attraction? No. It's a temptation. Is homosexuality a sin? Yes. Why? What's the difference? Well, 1 Timothy 1, Romans 1, 1 Corinthians 6, they all say that it is. That's when the desire leads to action. That's what occurs when the desire leads to action. So how about this one? This one might trip you up a little bit. Is it a sin to be a homosexual? Is it a sin to be gay? Think about this now. A homosexual is a person, by definition, it is a person who is attracted to someone of the same sex. Is it sinful to be attracted to someone of the same sex? Is it sinful to have a desire? No. All right. Another question. Can you be a gay Christian? In other words, can you be a person who is attracted to someone of the same sex and still submit your life to Christ? Now think about this. It's really no different in asking if you can be a heterosexual Christian. Heterosexual, this is really important. Heterosexuals and homosexuals both have to make a daily decision to surrender their desires to Christ. That is Christianity, like 101. No matter who you are or what your struggle is, we have to take that desire and submit it under the law of Christ. I left off the most awesome part of 1 Corinthians chapter 6. This is so awesome. Check this out. It's such an important verse for you guys to know. If you have friends who are dealing with same-sex attraction, or if you're dealing with same-sex attraction, I hope you'll write this passage on your heart and keep it close, and I hope it'll bless you. All right, one more time. Here's the part that we read earlier. It says 1 Corinthians 6, starting in verse 9, "Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." And then we get to verse 11. "And such were some of you." Wait a minute. Such were some of you. You mean Paul is writing to a group of Christians who used to do these things? He's writing to some men and women who had committed adultery and messed things up very badly. He's writing to some people who were known in that town for how much they got drunk. He's writing to people that were known in their town for being swindlers. That's kind of like people who are known for ripping people off and cheating them out of their money. He's writing to people who used to practice homosexuality. Did you see that phrase? Practice homosexuality. That's exactly what he says. Verse 11, "And such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." Now, wait a minute. A person can be gay and decide not to act on those feelings? Let me share a story with you. I used to attend a congregation. I used to worship at a church where the man who was the song leader was gay. But here's the thing. He didn't practice homosexuality. Instead, he submitted himself to the Lord. In fact, he stayed committed and stayed married to the woman that was his wife. Wow. I don't know about you, but to me, that sets a beautiful example. Instead of saying, I can live however I want to live, and those Christians over there and that church down the street, they can't stop me. Instead of doing that, he said, I know what the Bible teaches, and I'm going to surrender my desires to Jesus every day. Wow. That's a beautiful example, no matter what your desires are. So what do we do with all this? This is a heavy topic. And by the way, all of these topics at Summer Youth Series have been kind of heavy. But what do we do with this? I want to share with you a couple of thoughts that I think all of us need to bear in mind tonight. The first one is this, and I think this is for everybody, no matter who you are or where you are. Number one, I believe as Christians, we need to show radical compassion. Radical compassion, radical, this idea of something so new and different that it really stands out. In compassion, this idea of showing love, love in action. How can we have radical compassion? That's a phrase that I borrowed. I heard from Ralph Gilmore. I heard him say that one time when he was talking about this very topic. Radical, extreme, or drastic compassion, love, drastic love. There's a lot of things that the world gets wrong. There's a lot of things that the world gets wrong. And sometimes in the church, we're very quick to talk about things that the world does wrong. And as we should, the world does get a lot of things wrong. But I want to share with you two things that the world has gotten right. Number one, the world says, if you're gay, we love you. Number two, the world says, if you're mistreated because you're gay, we won't stand for it. To which I say, shouldn't we as the church be saying those very same things? If that's your struggle, we love you. If you're mistreated, if someone shows prejudice towards you for that reason, we shouldn't stand for that. Some people think that Christians are supposed to hate gay people. Where is that taught in God's word? That is as false can be. Jesus said, by this all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. When I read that verse, it tells me that Christians ought to be known for the way that we love gay people. And shouldn't we be leading the charge when it comes to matters of prejudice and injustice as well, and showing mercy and love and compassion whenever people are mistreated? Here's what that means, okay? Let me give you like youth group speak, why this matters and what this means to us. You're playing a game like apples to apples or quiplash, and you're trying to be funny. Don't make that joke about being gay. Stop calling people gay as an insult. Like, that's a great way to push people away. It's immature to do that. And so if that's something you're in the habit of doing, you need to stop. We don't need to make light of something that people in the church may be dealing with or are struggling with or facing. Feelings of same-sex attraction can be really difficult feelings to sort through, and nobody needs help in making difficult things more difficult. I would love to see the day in our youth groups where jokes like that aren't made anymore. Again, the church ought to be leading the charge and treating people right, and that means our youth groups ought to be leading the charge too. Second thing is this, second takeaway tonight. If you have feelings of same-sex attraction, please know that you are not doomed. Know that you can belong and you can be loved in God's church. I would encourage you to talk to somebody. Talk to someone who loves you and loves the Lord and seeks his wisdom. If you struggle, you are not weird. You are human, okay? All of us have different struggles, but we can all belong in the same body of Christ. What's supposed to set followers of Christ apart from the world is our decision to crucify our desires for his. You know, we have a t-shirt in our youth group. I'll show this to you. I guess it's on the tiny screen, so sorry to depart from the big screen for a moment. But we have t-shirts that we give to guests when they come. If you bring a guest to church with you or to to a youth group activity or something, we give out shirts that say, "Be long, be loved." And it's that very idea of in God's body, in the body of Christ, all of us have a place to belong, and all of us need to be loved. We all have that desire. And so I think that's an important thing for us to remember. Don't believe Satan's lies. You know, he'd love to drive you away from God's people, trying to convince you that the church will never love you for who you are. But remember, God loves you, and so do we. Tonight's lesson really comes down to one thing. Who are you going to listen to? Does Taylor Swift get to decide what's most important? Does the government? Do your friends' opinions run your life? Who are you going to listen to? Now, Joshua said it this way. If it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your father served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Listen, in some people's eyes, like it says, if you look at this verse, in some people's eyes, just like it says at the beginning of this verse, in some people's eyes, following God's will is evil. They will tell you that. That's what some people would say about this topic. But that is not true. God is loving. And everything he says in his will is set in a spirit of love. And just like Joshua says, you and I get to choose to serve whoever we want. You can choose to please people. You can choose what makes you feel good. You can choose what's most popular, or you can serve God. And he said, I'm going to tell you what we're going to do at my house. We're going to serve the Lord. Tonight, I know this is a heavy topic, but I want you to know that if there's somebody out there listening that's really struggled with same-sex attraction, I want to encourage you to talk to somebody that'll give you godly wisdom and insight. Maybe a counselor, somebody that can help you sort through really difficult feelings. It is a difficult thing to face and to deal with, but please know you're not alone. And in the body of Christ, you're not the only one who struggles. There are people who talk to counselors about all kinds of different things. You're not alone in your struggle. And God wants to help you. And his people, if they're living right, his people want to help too. Let's close in prayer, and then we'll take a few questions from the audience. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I pray that everything that was said tonight was said in the right way and in the right spirit. But also I pray I didn't compromise on your truth. I pray that the things that were spoken were correct. And all of us can get things wrong, and we need one another to help us see the scriptures in the right way. Help us to all be humble, to remember that all of us struggle, and you know that better than anyone. I pray that if there's anybody out there tonight that's struggling with this sin, I pray that you'd help them. And struggling with feelings, the feelings aren't sinful, but help them to know how to sort through those. And help us to do a better job listening and to show more compassion to those that are around us who are hurting. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right.
Sharing my screen. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Philip.
Thanks, Phil.
That was an excellent lesson. It's not an easy topic. And I know I was challenged personally listening to you. There's some great things to think about. And I want to encourage all of you out there. So many good things were said tonight. And I loved Philip's question that I want you to keep asking yourself is who are you going to listen to? And I think we as Christians, as people, Philip said it early on, doesn't matter what somebody's opinion is. Let's be people that go to the Word of God and say, what does God say? And let's listen to God's Word. Let's read God's Word and be people that follow it. Philip, we have a few questions that were submitted. You good to answer a few questions?
Let's do it, man. Let's try.
All right. The first question that was turned in, what do I do if I have a friend who confides in me that they are gay?
Man, that's a good question. I think, first of all, it says a lot that that friend would confide in you, you know, that they trust you enough to share something that's deeply personal with you. So I think that's important to keep in mind. It's not something that people say lightly. It's something that is very close to people's hearts. And so that's important. There's a word we kept saying tonight, the word compassion. It's important to remember to have compassion in everything that we do and everything that we say. So what do I do if I have a friend who confides in me if they're gay? I say love them, encourage them to seek godly counsel. Remember that the counsel of God is different than the counsel of men. And so someone who will encourage them to listen to what God says and not to a popular opinion or the news or whatever. I'd say do lots of listening. And this is a really important question. Are they willing to listen to what God says about a subject? If you have your Bibles open, I'd love for you to look at James 1:21. I think there's a beautiful phrase at the end of James 1:21 that I think is so important for us all to remember and to bear in mind. The last part of that verse says, "Receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls." Receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. And so that phrase right there is really important. Am I willing to receive God's word with meekness? That's an important question. It's one that we all need to be willing to answer. So what does it mean to receive God's word with meekness? Meekness, this state of mind, this state of humility. What I think helps me think about that is thinking about the opposite, all right? The opposite of receiving the word would be to reject the word. So the opposite of receiving the word would be to reject the word with meekness is, okay? The opposite of that is rejecting the word with arrogance, okay? So that's the attitude that says, I don't care what God says about that. I don't care what the Bible says about this. I know in my heart that what I'm doing is right. That's called foolish pride. And we all need to be humble enough to receive God's word with meekness and humility. And this goes for any subject, guys. It's a heart that says, you know what? Maybe I've been looking at this the wrong way. Maybe I've been thinking about that the wrong way. Can you help me see what God says about that topic? And if you have a friend that has that kind of heart and they confide in you something like that, and they're willing to look at what God's word says, that's an awesome heart to have, somebody that's willing to listen to God's wisdom and God's counsel. So that's what I would say. If you have a friend who confides in you that they're gay, love them and encourage them to seek God's wisdom.
That's a great answer. And I loved how Philip said tonight, Christians, we must show radical compassion. That's a powerful concept. And another thing I liked that he encouraged in his lesson was, Christian counseling. And I know in my life, there's a Christian counselor who has helped me tremendously through my life. And there are some great counselors. If there's something, an issue you're struggling with or you have questions about, talk to the leaders at your congregation. There may be a good counselor they could recommend that could help you process and deal with some questions you may have. Philip, the next question, how do I support a friend who is a homosexual without supporting a homosexual lifestyle?
Oh, okay. How do I support a friend who's a homosexual without supporting a homosexual lifestyle? I guess what I would say is I would hope that we would keep loving and supporting our friends in the same way, no matter what their temptations are. You know, if you have a friend who confides in you that they're tempted with pornography, do you stop being their friend? No. You support them, you pray for them, you check on them, you keep talking to them, you keep on being their friend. But when that friend says, hey, listen, I'm tired of fighting this. I'm just into pornography and that's who I am. We need to speak to that friend lovingly, but also truthfully. Hey, man, listen, I love you, but have you considered what God's word says about that? They might say, no, I really hadn't thought about that. you might say, well, can we study that together? But then there's the other side where someone might say, yeah, I know exactly what God says, but I don't care. Well, to me, that's different. We still need to pray for them, but an outright rebellion against what God says is different than someone who says, hey, I can use a little help and a little support and a little guidance. Those are different kind of hearts, I think.
Good answer. Next question. How do I approach trying to convert a friend who is in a homosexual relationship?
How do I approach trying to convert a friend who's in a homosexual relationship? I think that we live in a culture. It's not just culture. It's really probably been this way forever, ever since, you know, Paul was walking around and trying to convert people. Some people violate God's word and they have no idea. You know, no one has ever told them otherwise. They've never told them what God's word teaches about a particular issue. For instance, the people in Ephesus, when Paul taught them and they realized that they needed to surrender their lives to God and follow Jesus. I don't know if you remember the story, but they had like all these books of magic and like witchcraft and sorcery. And they took all that stuff and they made like a giant bonfire. And it was worth like 50,000 pieces of silver. And so what we see there is they didn't know God, but once they did, they saw what they needed to do to repent and they did it. So that's category number one, somebody who doesn't know any better because nobody's ever taught them. And that seems to be the case with 1 Corinthians 6 that we looked at earlier. Here's another category. And I think this one may be where a lot of our culture is. They think they know what God's word says, and they have an inaccurate view of God because maybe they were told something like this. Perhaps they were told that Christianity is about hating gay people. They said, well, you know, Christians hate gay people. And they decided, well, if that's how Christianity is, I'm out. I don't want anything to do with it. So that's category number two. They've been taught an inaccurate thing about it. Category three, I think there's some that know God's word and they know what it says, but they don't care. I want to encourage all of us to be a friend who will show them the most accurate view of who God is and what God says. Love that friend as you would love anybody who's caught up in any other sin. And by the way, if you have a friend, you have a friend who sometimes gets caught up in sin because we all do. So that would be my advice. I feel like what I've said in every answer so far has been love people, love people, love people. And if we do a good job loving people, a lot of times we have opportunities to speak truth. And that's really what the whole series has been about this summer. If we love people the way Jesus loved people, we have an opportunity to speak God's truth to their life.
Absolutely. You know, and it reminds me, you know, the old saying that's still true, people don't care what you know until they know that you care. And I think what Philip is saying, we as Christians, we have to be people of love. We have to be people that love people. And I think if you're being that kind of Christian, a true Christian that loves others, that's when people are going to come to you. And that's when people are going to listen to you when you point them to God's word. You know, when they see your example and you are somebody that loves somebody, that you're somebody that cares. You know, and you're not trying to win an argument or a fight or be right or whatever. You get to take one more question?
I'll do my best, man.
Okay. A last question we're going to ask while we got Philip on the hot seat right here is, what should I do if I find out I have feelings for someone of the same sex?
I've heard it said before with this topic that it can be one of the loneliest roads to walk. And I don't mean it like there's nobody else who struggles with it, but it can be a very hard road to walk if you try to walk it alone. And so I think sharing what you're feeling with someone who can help you through that is so healthy. And that goes for any topic. You know, if in your past you deal with some abuse, it doesn't help to hold all that in. It helps to talk through that and work through that in the right way and in the healthy way. And in the healthy way is with someone who will give you godly wisdom. And so a Christian counselor that you can trust. And Phil mentioned it earlier, but if you need connections of, hey, you know, talking to a youth minister or a youth minister's wife or someone in the church that you trust and saying, hey, can you help me find somebody that I can talk to? I could use some help. And you can leave it at that. And a good counselor can help you through that. So that's a great question. And I really hope if like a couple of good things happen from this lesson tonight, I hope that somebody who's going through this and struggling with this, if they get some help, I feel like we've done something good. But also, if this is not your struggle and you've had your ears attuned to something that maybe you haven't thought about before, is how can I do a better job showing people compassion that this is their struggle? Then we've done two really good things. If we help somebody struggling, and if we, somebody who's struggling with it, and if we learn how to help people who struggle with it, we've done something good.
We love you, Philip, and I love you as a brother. And thank you for taking the time tonight. And you know, Philip is a great example. You know, we can't just talk the talk as Christians. We have to walk the walk. And Philip is someone that does love everyone and shows the love of Jesus for everyone he meets. And that's the kind of people we have to be. We must show that radical compassion. And I thank Philip for a wonderful lesson tonight and taking the time to answer some of these questions. Want to encourage you. One cool thing is, if I was over here taking notes, but this will be up on the YouTube Summer Youth Series channel. So if you want to watch it again or recommend it to your friends who didn't get to watch tonight, you can go back or get the scripture references Philip mentioned. We do want to mention, as you see on the screen, there is more Summer Youth Series to come this summer. Next week, we have another Jenkins to speak to you. And Southern Hills is hosting July 16th, next Thursday night. Drake Jenkins is going to be speaking the truth in love on speech. And we love Drake Jenkins. Drake is Philip's first cousin. Is that right?
Yeah. He's one of my cousins.
So Drake, I'm sure will do a wonderful job. And make sure you spread the word. It looks like we have four Summer Youth Series left. And that will be online again next week. We want to thank Keith O'Neill and the Concord Road congregation for putting this together, and Keith for all his help getting this together tonight, and certainly thank Philip Jenkins. We will close with a word of prayer, and we certainly thank you all out there for joining us, singing with us, worshiping with us, and we hope to see you all next week and hope to see you all in person very soon. Let's go to God in prayer. Our Father in heaven, Father, we love you so much. And Father, we thank you for loving us. We thank you, Father, for your grace and your mercy. Father, we thank you for forgiving us when we do fall, for forgiving us when we sin against you. Father, I thank you for the lesson we heard tonight. And Father, I thank you that Philip so capably shared some of your word with us tonight. And Father, I pray that you'll be with all of us, be with these young people. Help us to be people that dig deeper in your word, that study your word every day. Write your word on our hearts, Father, on our mind. Help us to think about the scripture we read tonight. Father, help us to meditate on your word and to live by it. Father, help us to be people, as your children, that have a radical compassion. Father, help us to be people, as Christians, as your children, that love everyone, that love others, that love those who may struggle with homosexuality, Father. Father, help us to be there for our friends, encourage them, and always be people of love, and help us to continue to speak the truth in love, Father. Father, help us to, as Philip encouraged us, help us to point our friends to you, to point our friends to your son, Jesus, and to your word. Father, help us to not go to social media for answers, not go to celebrities for their opinions, but Father, to go to the truth, which is your word. Father, guide us, give us wisdom, give us strength, Father. Help everyone out there, help us with the temptations we face every day. And Father, we know that Satan is roaming about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Help us be strong. Help us to resist temptation and to live more like your son, Jesus, every day. Father, we pray that we might be together with you, that we might have a home in heaven with you after this life. And we thank you for that hope we have because of the sacrifice of your son, Jesus, on the cross. Father, all these things we ask in the name of your precious son, Jesus. Amen. Thank you all for joining us. Y'all have a great night. Thank you, Philip.
Absolutely. Thanks, guys.
See you next week.